a political reporter here on BBC Radio Leicester. Well, we're sort of drifting towards a discussion of numbers there. Our guide to the numbers all the way since before the beginning of March has been Dr. Duncan Robertson from Loughborough University School of Business and Economics. Duncan's with us again. Hi, Duncan.
Morning, Ben. Hi.
OK, so talk us through the numbers. Talk us through your response to what you've just seen as well.
Well, I think it's obviously quite concerning, and it's not as though this is a new problem, because this is basically the scientist there, the chief medical officer and the chief scientific advisor, basically saying this is the science. So it's up to the politicians to decide what to do with that science. And it's also not as though they've just come up with this view now. I think on the 14th of July, the chief scientific advisor set out a report. And what he was doing there is he was saying, this is the science at that time, and this is our prediction. And at that time, he said, basically, there's a reasonable worst case scenario of 119,000 deaths, which is double, basically, the first wave. So it's quite important that that message has got across to politicians. And then, of course, it's for politicians to decide what to do with that.
Right at the beginning of this, there was always talk of the second wave, wasn't there? I think it's not unreasonable. A lot of us put it to the back of our minds, thinking, can we just deal with the first wave first? Now that the second wave would seem to be at or upon us, why is it often that the second waves are seen to be, and we've seen this in pandemics in the past, why is it that the second waves are often more deadly than the first?
Well, that's a very good question. And if you go right back to the early press conferences, that was one of the reasons for delaying the sort of first lockdown, is that we can know that these waves can come back. You know, look at the 1918 flu. I think it's an important thing to say, this is not a second wave that's coming from anywhere else. This has basically been brewing, and Deputy Chief Chief Medical Officer was saying, you know, if you unlock this coiled spring too quickly, it's going to come out and, you know, effectively smack you in the face. And that's essentially what could be happening now, is that if you listen to these briefings, scientists are saying very, very, very clearly, don't overcook it, don't overdo the release of lockdown. And of course, politicians then decide what to do. And of course, they have to balance the economic side of things and the epidemic. So essentially, if you release all the things, if you open the pubs, et cetera, your workplaces, if you allow people to mix, then of course, the infection is going to spread. And that helps the economy in the short term, but potentially allows this epidemic to double and then double again. And that's what's happening now.
So, as you say, we've seen, and you can sort of see why a politician's decision is a difficult one, isn't it? From the perspective of, you know, the hospitality industry on its knees, you've got to open it up at some point or sacrifice it. The decision to sacrifice it is not something that you could easily make. So, you open up the hospitality trade, you do eat out to help out, all that kind of thing. Schools reopen, although it was interesting to see that the amount of infections amongst children, I didn't see whether that was specific about school age children or not, but that doesn't seem to be rising as much, or at least the least amount. And then, of course, we see universities in the process of going back, hundreds of thousands of students and their parents and carers travelling up and down the country to deliver them off. Are those all having consequences?
Well, basically, it's to do with mixing. And I think one thing that was quite clear there, and I've done my own research on this, is who is being infected. So it started in 20-year-olds. Those are people who are basically most active in the economy. They go to pubs. They are maybe they're helping you in the shops, etc. And it then spreads, and it's spreading to the over 80s, and that's the kind of bad thing, because the thing about this disease is it's young people have a very low chance of suffering from it. Once you're over 80, you have a very high chance of suffering from it. And that's what's happening. It's now in the over 80s. And that's essentially where, you know, potentially bad things can happen. So it's kind of important that, you know, we prevent this mixing, not just amongst young people, but amongst everybody, because it will spread up to these very susceptible age groups. And also, we don't know, you know, am I susceptible to it? I don't really know. I don't really want to find out.
Duncan, help me out with this, because my 14-year-old son yesterday, and we were trying to find what the sort of scientific reason is, but help us out here. So he said to me yesterday, why is it that only we can only be six people together, but people could go to the pub or a restaurant where, again, it's just groups of six, but you're essentially in the same building together. Why is that? Is it just a kind of a numbers game ultimately?
Your 14-year-old son has a very good question, one which I can't answer. But, you know, the point is, it's essentially just to restrict transmission. And it's a very good point, because where does it spread? It spreads mostly in areas which are indoors. So that's one reason. If you're inviting people round to your house, you don't want many people being spread to them. But also, in environments which are enclosed, you don't want to mix there either. So, you know, it tends to mix much better. And one thing that came out in the press conference today was aerosol transmission. So it's not just droplets, it's aerosol as well. And that, you know, isn't good indoors. So essentially, indoors is a bad thing. And numbers is a political decision.
Duncan, thank you ever so much for joining us again. Again, maybe we need to talk a bit later on in the week just to see when some more of this science kind of gets done and so on. And it would seem it's interesting that the words, I don't think we used it anyway, track and trace seems to be the along with vaccines, track and trace seems to be the crucial, critical way of getting out of this.
Absolutely. 14th of July, the scientists wrote it down. Basically, it's the heart of things, and unfortunately, it's breaking down at the moment.
All right, Duncan, thank you. There you go. Dr. Duncan Robertson from Loughborough University School of Business and Economics, been our guide to the numbers all the way through since March, every Monday. I have a feeling we will be talking to him again sooner rather than we imagine.